This conference will now be recorded.
Hello, good morning, and welcome everyone to the HCM Cloud session.
Good morning, Venkat. This is Kala here.
Very good morning, Kala. Hope you are all able to hear me.
Yes.
Yes, Venkat. This is Sheshu from Bangalore.
Very good morning. So before I start the session, I request all of you to keep your mics on mute so that we avoid the disturbances from each other, which will cause an inconvenience to everyone. Unless until there is a requirement, you please keep your mics on mute. And during the session, if you have any questions or queries, I will give you time. When I ask, then you can unmute and you can speak. Okay, that's the way we follow so that we don't cause inconvenience to others because of the background noises. Okay, so please keep this in mind and keep your mics on mute. Whoever is joining also, please keep your mics on mute. So just to clarify to all of you who have joined this session, this is the demo session for HCM Cloud online training. By mistake, if you have joined, because I have seen earlier some people after joining, they ask, is it not financial session? Definitely not. It is a HCM Cloud session. Okay. Right. So we will go ahead with the session. So now onwards, I'll be taking you through the HCM Cloud online training. And if you have any issues with respect to the training, you have the contact number, you have the mail ID. So the agenda for this demonstration session for the day one, we will talk in general about the cloud, and we also talk about Oracle cloud models, SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS, and we'll discuss some of the benefits derived out of the Oracle cloud, because Oracle is one of the cloud provider, and we are going to learn about Oracle HCM Cloud. So we'll discuss some of the benefits of the Oracle Cloud. And very importantly, those who want to pursue your career in the cloud applications, first we must understand what is the key differences between the cloud and the on-premise applications. So we will bring forth those differences a little bit. And then we will start with introduction to the Oracle Cloud or the Fusion Cloud applications. And I will also take you through the cloud architecture, how it was built. And we'll also talk about the deployment models available and the technologies behind the building of the cloud applications. And also we will briefly discuss about the enterprise structure, what is used in the cloud applications. And finally, I'll close the talk by walking you through the course curriculum, which we are going to cover in the next few days. So first we will start with the, in general, what is cloud computing? So cloud computing is basically a broad term which describes broad range of services. So to truly understand how the cloud can be of value to an organization, first it is important to understand what the cloud really is and its different components. Since the cloud is a broad collection of services, organizations can choose where, when, and how they use the cloud computing. So cloud computing is a model for enabling convenient as well as on-demand network access to a shared pool of configurable computing resources. When we say computing resources, it could be networks, servers, storage, applications, and services, which can be rapidly provisioned and released with very minimal management effort or with minimal service provider interaction. That is the basic requirement of the cloud computing. What this means in plain terms is the ability for end users to utilize parts of bulk resources, and these resources can be acquired quickly and easily. That is the basic meaning of the cloud computing. So we want to have the utilization of the bulk resources in parts, and that too we should be able to acquire them quickly and easily. So the cloud computing is characterized by certain information. What are those characteristics? Are one is on-demand self-service. That means the ability for an end user to sign up and receive services without long delays. That is the first characteristics of the cloud. Second is broad network access. That means ability to access the service via the standard platforms, maybe your desktops, laptops, or even nowadays we have a lot of handheld devices like mobile phones or iPads, iPhones, whatever it is. And third is resource pooling. Resources are pooled across multiple customers, and rapid elasticity, which means capability can scale to cope with demand of the peaks. And very importantly, measured service. That is, billing is metered and delivered as a utility service. So the organizations who opt for the cloud, they will be billed based on the utilization. That means, in other way, we say the organizations who subscribe will be billed on pays as you go basis. So that is about the basic cloud computing. And in the cloud computing, we mainly come across with three distinct categories. We call them as software as a service, platform as a service, and infrastructure as a service. So in this diagram, those three are being depicted in such a way that the base will be infrastructure as a service, or which the platform as a service will be built, and on the top you will have the software as a service. So these are the three distinct categories within the cloud computing, popularly known as SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. Software as a service, platform as a service, and the infrastructure as a service. And out of this, the SaaS or the software as a service applications are designed for end users, which are delivered over the internet. And PaaS is mainly set of tools and services which are designed to make coding and deploying applications quickly and efficiently. And the third one, infrastructure as a service, is the hardware and the software which powers it all. So your platform as a service, your software as a service are basically dependent on the infrastructure, which is infrastructure as a service, like your servers, storage, networks, operating system, everything. So to speak about broadly, to understand how these will be making a difference for us. So software as a service, which defines basically software that is deployed over the internet, which we talked about. So with the software as a service, the provider here could be like in the market, we have a lot of SaaS providers. Oracle is one of them. And I always talk in terms of Oracle only because that's what we are going to learn. Though there are many service providers are there with respect to the SaaS, but we limit to the Oracle because we are going to learn about the Oracle HCM cloud. So with SaaS, a provider, that means here the Oracle, licenses an application to customers as a service on demand through a subscription in a pay as you go model. What it means is, unlike your on-premise applications, like you have traditionally e-business, PeopleSoft, etc., where the customers has to buy the license, but here the customer need not to buy any license. Instead, they'll be pay as you go model. That means you pay for whatever you are using, and whenever you don't want, you can leave that. So that is the basic requirement of the software as a service. So software as a service, cloud application services, or we call them as software as a service, SaaS, are the most popular form of cloud computing and are very easy to use. So SaaS uses the web to deliver the applications that are managed by third-party vendor, in this again Oracle, and whose interface is accessed on the client side. So Oracle is the service provider, and the organization which brings or which gets the subscription to use will be getting that interface. And the very beauty of the SaaS is you can access the application, SaaS applications, or the internet anywhere in the world. Just you need a browser and an internet connection. So that based on the subscriptions you have subscribed, you will be able to access the applications anywhere on any device, whether it is desktop or laptop or mobile, whatever the case may be. So the very purpose of the SaaS is to eliminate the need to install and run applications on individual computers. You need not to do that. Whatever browser you have, if you have the internet connection, you will be able to access that. With SaaS, it is easy for the enterprises to streamline their maintenance and support because everything can be managed by the vendors. That means vendors will manage the applications, vendors will manage the runtime, the data, middleware, OS, virtualization, servers, storage, networking, everything will be managed by the vendors. So from the organization point of view, you have drastically reduction in the maintenance as well as support activities. Software as a service allows users to subscribe and use application software in the cloud. A modern cloud suite provides complete software for your entire business so that you can subscribe to certain SaaS applications as needed. So it is not mandatory that the organizations which are subscribing for the SaaS application onto their business need to have everything. So it depends upon your business. Whatever your business demands, you can subscribe and make use of those SaaS applications to help and grow your business. Like maybe some organizations interested in the accounting and finance part on the SaaS, or they want procurement, project management, sales, HR, services, marketing, whatever, supply chain, you can name any such things. And the service providers mostly will cover the entire business suite of applications. It's not that they'll say only we will provide HR or only we will provide financials or project portfolio management or so. Most of the providers will provide, especially Oracle, will provide everything needed for the business. Now it is the organizations to decide and subscribe and make use of those SaaS applications. So that's why we call them as suite of applications. A modern SaaS cloud application suite enables users to personalize software for their role. And with a modern SaaS suite, you can easily connect your entire business from any device, anywhere. And you can connect to other clouds and integrate to existing systems as well. And presently in the market, SaaS is rapidly growing. And this rapid growth basically indicates that the SaaS applications will soon become commonplace, because with everyone around us are moving to the SaaS applications. If you are running an organization, your vendors, your customers may be moving to the cloud applications or SaaS applications. So definitely a need arises for us also to move so that we can have the synchronization between our people. So because this is rapidly growing in the market, and we need to have that synchronization between the organizations, because organizations alone cannot run the business. So definitely we need that information. So most of the organizations are looking to get into the SaaS applications and the related technology. So this is briefly about the SaaS applications. Any questions, any queries you have, you are welcome. Then I'll talk about PaaS and IaaS as well. Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
HCM also comes under SaaS only, right?
Yes. When we say applications for the end users, your HCM, your financials, supply chain, procurement, everything comes under the SaaS.
Yeah, thank you.
Venkat, okay, so what about the security?
Security is also part of your SaaS only, because when we say HCM is a SaaS application, now within HCM, which or how the users will be able to access the information. So no organization definitely allows all the HCM users to see everything within the applications. That is where the security comes into picture. So security is a part of your SaaS application.
Okay.
One of the feature, you can say. Yeah. Which will be taken care of. Okay, all right. Though we are mainly focusing on the SaaS part in our training, that is purely the functional part of the HCM, but still we will talk about little bit about PaaS and the infrastructure as a service as well, so that when you work with the SaaS applications, you should understand what is the role of platform as a service and the infrastructure as a service, which are basically the technical things which help the SaaS applications to be deployed on the front end. Because when we look at the television screen, whatever is playing and when we are seeing, like Big Boss or whatever it is, just we are seeing it on the screen, but there are a lot of things behind it, right? You have a dish, and with that dish direction only you will be able to see the clear picture. And that dishes are connected somewhere to some service providers like Tata Sky or something. So the infrastructure, the platform behind that help us to see on in your drawing room or in your bedroom when you have a TV screen, what you are seeing and what you are able to see and control the volume and brightness, etc. So there is something behind that which makes it to happen. So that is where your PaaS and IaaS comes into picture. And whereas your SaaS is your interacting interface application where you are directly going to work with. So platform as a service basically allows developers, IT professionals and business leaders to develop, test and deploy the next generation applications in the cloud in a secure, cost-effective manner. And also this will be speeding up time to market and increases the competitive advantage. So as I said, the PaaS is basically behind the screen, which happens, which make it happens for the SaaS to work for the end users from the front end. So platform as a service, as the name suggests, provides us computing platforms, which typically includes your operating systems, your programming language execution environment, database, web server, etc. And platform as a service is more popular among developers because they can put all their concentration on developing their apps and leave the rest of management and execution to the service provider. Otherwise, what will happen? You need to even worry for that. Whereas if you are subscribing for PaaS, the developers will be able to put all their concentration on developing their apps and the rest of the management and execution will be looked after by the service provider, which is Oracle in this case. And many service providers also offer the flexibility to increase or decrease the CPU power depending upon the traffic loads. Thereby, it gives the developers cost effectiveness and easy and effortless management of the development. And basically because of this, what developers gains is a framework which they can build upon to develop or customize the applications. So the framework will be provided by the PaaS and developers will be able to just develop their applications accordingly. So PaaS makes the development, testing and deployment of applications quickly, simply and cost effective way, thereby eliminating the need to buy the underlying layers of hardware and software. And platform as a service is again one of the growing sector of cloud computing because see basically most of the organizations when they do the business, they have a lot of things to be interfaced with the present applications. Suppose you are taking the HCM cloud SaaS services. But with that alone, you may not be able to run your business. You may have to interface with some recruiting agency, or you may have to interface with some background check third party for your recruitments, or you may have some travel agency interfaced so that whenever employee wants to travel, they have to book their tickets through the travel agency, which is again a third party application. So you need to develop a lot of interfaces and most of the organizations will do that, which is definitely required to run your business smoothly. So whenever we want to have such interfaces to be associated with your main SaaS applications, definitely the PaaS will be of help. So most of the SaaS subscribers will also try to have the PaaS because the underlying infrastructure or the platform required for developing those interfaces will be provided by the providers, especially the Oracle, and because of which the developers will be able to concentrate where they can interface other applications with your SaaS applications. So that is the basic requirement of the PaaS. So PaaS is especially useful in any situation where multiple developers will be working on a development project or where other external parties need to interact with the development process. That is the best part of the PaaS. Then the base, the infrastructure over which you have your PaaS built and your SaaS built, infrastructure as a service, is a way of delivering cloud computing infrastructure. Basically, the servers, storage, operating system, these all will be provided on a on-demand service. So rather than purchasing your servers, software, data center, space, or network equipment, clients will buy those resources as a fully outsourced service on demand. That is the basic infrastructure service. And because of which, upfront cost for the clients who are going to subscribe will be drastically reduced. Otherwise, to set up your ERP applications or HCM cloud applications, you may need to have a space where you have to establish your data center. You need to physically buy all these servers and all those things. You need a lot of resources to deploy them, to maintain them. This all can be avoided with the infrastructure as a service. So, where basically the infrastructure as a service makes sense for the organizations, situations that are particularly suitable for cloud infrastructure may be like new organizations without the capital to invest in hardware, and where the organization is growing rapidly and scaling hardware would be an issue. So, especially for those, definitely infrastructure as a service, if they opt, then upfront cost will be drastically reduced, especially the new organizations who are investing into business. So infrastructure as a service, as the name suggests, provides you the computing infrastructure, physical or virtual machines and other resources like disk image library, block and file based storage, firewalls, load balancers, IP addresses, virtual local area networks, whatnot. And infrastructure as a service is more popular among users into research and high computing areas. Okay. So this is basically about the infrastructure as a service. So using the infrastructure as a service is basically exchange for a rental fee. A third party allows you to install a virtual server on their IT infrastructure. That's what is basically happening. Okay. And what users gain with infrastructure as a service is infrastructure on top of which they can install any required platforms. Okay. Now we would like to bring in few differences between cloud and the on-premise, because so far most of us are habitual of working with the on-premise applications. I'm sure most of you must have worked with either PeopleSoft or eBusiness or maybe with Hyperion or whatever, or Siebel. So now cloud has come into picture only around 2011 or 12. Though it was rolled out in 2010 by Oracle, but it became popular only around 2011-12, at least I came to know. And from there onwards, people started moving towards the cloud applications. But the mindset of the people is with the on-premise applications. So definitely people needs to change their mindset and start working with the cloud applications. Now, to have that, first of all, you should be aware what will be there, what will not be there in the cloud applications in comparison with the on-premise applications. So first, in the on-premise applications, we means here the client organizations who are opting on-premise applications will have upfront investment. As we said, if you want to have on-premise applications, you have to buy the license first of all For that, you have to provide the license fee to the providers, maybe Oracle or SAP, whatever the case may be. And you should have a huge space to set up your data center. You need to physically buy the servers. You need to have a lot of technical resources to install them, to provision them, to manage them. So a lot of upfront investment is required. And to maintain and support them, you need a lot of costs annually. You have to invest on annual support costs, because a lot of times you need a lot of resources. And definitely these are all the physical hardware, servers, etc., which may get damaged. So you need to replace them. So that also costs you. And sometimes you may not have the proper technical resources team to manage them. So you may have to outsource that. And for that, you need to spend a lot of money. So not only upfront investment during beginning, as well as it will be a recurring annual support cost. And whenever the provider comes out with some upgrades and issues some patches, it becomes a headache on the client organization to look after those things. Like most of you must be aware, I'm not sure how many of you have worked with your earlier applications like eBusiness or PeopleSoft or Siebel. At least Oracle has got the eBusiness applications and the PeopleSoft and Siebel. So they must have started with some version and they kept on moving to different versions. Like those who are from eBusiness, you know, there is 11A applications. In 11A applications also 11.5, 11.7, 11.9, 11.10. Like that, it was kept on moving. Then they moved to suddenly release 12. 12.0, 12.1, 12.1.1, 12.1.2, then 12.2. Like this, they kept on moving to the new releases. Same way, PeopleSoft, if you take 8.8, 8.9, 9.0, 9.1, 9.2, they'll be kept on moving. And whenever you implement your application, say for example, on PeopleSoft 9.0, then Oracle moved it to 9.2. Now, to upgrade, you have to take your own investment as well as your own decision. Oracle is not bothered because they are kept on moving with the new releases, with the new functionalities, whatnot. And data center and hardware costs includes disaster recovery. If there is any failures, you need to invest a lot on their recovery as well. Costly customizations created and maintained. This is another big headache with the on-premise applications, because they allow customizations, because you have licensed the product, people will do left and right lot of customizations. Suppose you are on PeopleSoft 9.0 and done 80% of your applications customized. Now when you want to move to 9.2, you need to look after. Upgradations will not take care of the customizations. So you need to take care of those customizations, which will be again becomes a burden. And the retention of own or IT subcontract staff required, because you have licensed the applications, you have the infrastructure, you have the data center, you have the servers, you have the storage. So you need a lot of IT resources to maintain them. Managing own network security and access, and outdated software resulting in missed business benefit. So you are on 9.0 of the PeopleSoft or 12.0 of eBusiness applications, and Oracle has already brought in the upgrades in the PeopleSoft to 9.2 and maybe in the eBusiness 12.2. So if you want to move, you have to again make your own efforts and invest money. If you don't move, you are stuck with an obsolete version, because already your competitors has gone ahead and taken that business benefit out of those upgrades, and maybe they may be having a lot of new functionalities, new features which you may be missing. So that is another problem. If you want to upgrade, you have to invest. If you don't upgrade, you are stuck with some business benefits missing. Now to address all these things, cloud applications came into market. In the cloud applications, you rent a flexible service, pay as you grow. So software as a service. So you are just subscribing. You are not taking the license. And today you are just a starter, a beginner with around 1,000 employees. Tomorrow your business grows. You start growing. And as long as your users are kept on using the applications, you will be billed accordingly and keep subscribing accordingly. So pay as you use model is adopted. And the client organizations will act as a business super users rather than the IT support. So you need not to worry about how to install them, how to manage the infrastructure, how to have a space for the data center. All these things are least bothered because you are just using as a business user. You don't need worry much about the IT side of the applications. Standard security and access anywhere, whenever, wherever. So you just need a browser and the internet connection. Wherever you want, you can access the applications, but definitely with standard security and embedded modern best practice and the processes. And in the cloud applications also, the providers will be keep moving to the new releases with the new functionalities. And always they will try to take you to those levels, unlike your on-premise application. So always the client organizations will be having the modern best practices and processes available within the industry. And no upgrades, but latest functionalities via regular releases. So no upgrades, we can't say much because sometimes there will be upgrades happens, but here continuous releases will be there. Every after release, some new functionality will be added or some existing functionality will be streamlined or enhanced so that it will be useful for the business. And on a cloud applications, this will be taken care by the providers. Like if you subscribe for HCM cloud for Oracle, for example, right now we are in the release 13 in the market. Release 13 has got again 4 releases. Release 13 with 18A. 18 stands for 2018 year and A is for the first quarter. Like that, Oracle kept on releasing the releases in each quarter and each year. Like last year, 17A, 17B, 17C, 17D, 4 releases came. Okay. Then with the same release 13, now 18A started. 18A means first quarter, January, February, March. Then April, May, June, 18B. Then July, August, September, C. October, November, December, they'll issue the D. So like that, and Oracle will automatically take care of in each release, whatever the new functionalities are introduced, whatever streamlining of the existing functionalities happens, that will be taken care by Oracle. So that is about the platform, cloud platform and the on-premise. Any questions, any queries?
One quick question on the platform as a service, just along with the SaaS, what are the typical PaaS applications that are in use, that we normally use?
No, PaaS is not the application actually. PaaS is behind and it happens the SaaS applications available in the front end. So PaaS is basically a platform to develop your interfaces, etc. It will provide you that infrastructure.
Okay. And any components within the PaaS that we typically use for our integrations with the Oracle SaaS?
Yeah, Oracle has got a lot of such platform as a service. Okay. I'm not much sure about them, the namings of those platforms, but yeah, definitely a lot of such services are provided as PaaS. so that you will be able to do some customizations. You will be able to develop some interfaces. Okay.
Okay.
So the basic outline will be provided. Yeah.
Okay.
Means in simple terms, I can say you need not to even worry about even programming and all those things. Somebody need not to know any programming language. That service will be provided to you. Just make use of it and build your interface easily. That's way the platform as a service will be helpful for us. Otherwise, you have to write a lot of scripts. You may have to write some programming language. You need that skills and etc. But with a pass, Oracle will provide you those things. And just you need to go step by step and get your things done. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hi Venkat, this is Rupali here.
Yeah.
We don't have this patches concept in a cloud application like the way we had in eBiz. Like, you know, if we are stuck in some issue, then Oracle will reply back to apply this patch to get the issue resolved.
Yes, we have. We have in cloud also. But the beauty here is Oracle will apply those patches. We need not to do that.
It'll be maintaining like regularly. We don't need to bother about the patches and all that has come.
Yes, Oracle will do that. They inform you that, okay, we are applying patch of so and so on this Friday on your test instance, then maybe next Friday on your production instance, be ready. Like that, they'll give the schedule and accordingly they do it.
Okay, thanks.
Right. So that's why we say a lot of resources in terms of support and maintenance will be reduced for the client organizations. So they need not to worry much about those things.
So just one more thing, like in cloud, we don't need to have our personal DBA like the way we had in eBase. It is like the DBA thing is taken care by Oracle.
Yes, yes. So one way I can say, the number of technical resources requirement will come down in the market with respect to the client organizations. Yeah, as you said, you don't need them because there is nothing to manage and maintain from your end. But definitely don't worry, those who are DBAs and all, with this statement, you need not to worry that because that demand is always there. Then you have to go to the provider side. Okay. Right. So as we talked about in general, what are the cloud computing definition and what are the three distinct categories of the SaaS, PaaS and IaaS. Now, as I said, in the market, we have a lot of competitors with respect to the cloud. So we are going to learn about Oracle Cloud. Oracle is one of the biggest provider for the cloud, though there are number of competitors available in the market. So we are going to look at what is Oracle Cloud is all about. So Oracle Cloud applications are a complete and modular set of enterprise applications engineered from the ground up to be cloud ready and coexist seamlessly in mixed environments. This is very, very important to understand. Most of us who are moving towards the cloud applications are in a wrong thought process, thinking that, okay, Oracle has got the e-business applications, so this is an upgraded version of e-business applications. Or they have the PeopleSoft, so this is a refined version of PeopleSoft, nothing like that. HCM cloud applications are built from the scratch, not only for that HCM, any cloud application which was provided by the Oracle are built from the scratch. Ground up means built from the scratch. It is not an enrichment, not an extension, not a refinement to the any existing Oracle applications, be it PeopleSoft or eBusiness or Siebel, whatever the case may be. Okay. So cloud applications are engineered and built from the scratch. Only thing is Oracle has already experienced in the ERP market with a lot of ERP applications, like eBusiness was the own product of Oracle. Then Oracle has acquired like PeopleSoft, Siebel, Hyperion, JD Edwards, whatnot. So they have a lot of rich experience, and because of that, they know what is the client requirements. So keeping all the things in the mind, and each product has got their own best features. Like if you look at, especially HCM, Oracle eBusiness is the HCM applications from the Oracle own, but they have acquired PeopleSoft, and PeopleSoft has got many best features. So they have taken the best features from both eBusiness applications and PeopleSoft, and they built the cloud applications. So it is best of best. So that is the how the cloud applications, okay? And they also built in such a way that they coexist seamlessly in mixed environments. That means some of the customers, their core applications are in eBusiness HCM. They don't want to move out of that. Still, they want to maintain their employees, everything in eBusiness applications, but they want to taste the flavor of cloud applications. So they want to implement only performance management of cloud applications. Okay, only for giving you employee ratings at the year end, appraisals. That is what is the performance management. So that only they want to taste. So this is what we call it as coexistence. Coexistence means you need not to move from your core eBusiness applications or PeopleSoft applications. Your core employee data will be maintained there, but you want to have plug and play some cloud applications, say performance management, for example. So there it will seamlessly works. That is what is the coexistence. So this is the model which brought by Oracle in the early stages, especially when the cloud was newly introduced in the market. Definitely many people are not ready, because nobody believes if some change comes in the market, or even if you talk about common society, in the society also, any change comes up, we don't immediately accept that until unless it is proved. Okay, a few people will be there who come forward and say, like simple example I'll take, maybe it may be right or wrong. Like earlier we used to have examinations for engineering admissions, entrance examinations, or for medical entrance. So everybody will have their own entrance. SRM University will have their own entrance. Okay, Getham University will have their own entrance. This Ramchandra University will have, Andhra University will have, like that. And one person, he has to get the admission into engineering or medical, they have to write different examinations. AIIMS will conduct one thing. Okay, JIPMER will conduct another examination. So scattered, and definitely it will be having very stress on the student's mind. So then they come out with something called NEET, which will be a common examination. You pass that examination, anywhere you got admission throughout India, you will get it. Ranking will be one ranking. So all the colleges, all the universities, whether private or public, government, everything has to participate in that. Like that, they brought in. So which they are going to do same model for even for the lot of competitive examinations, okay? So that you need not to appear for different examinations to get into different things. So like that, people were very resisting that NEET examination initially. Whether it is good or bad, I'm not going to discuss that. That depends upon the people and how they are affected. But initially, any change brought into the society, people will straight away don't accept that. So same way, when the cloud applications are brought into the market, many existing client organizations are not ready to take up that. So Oracle has come out with a ideology, coexist. You don't move. Your core application still you maintain in your e-business or PeopleSoft, which you feel comfortable, but just plug and play some modules from the cloud and test them. If you feel okay, then later you may move. So this was the strategy adopted. So this is where lot of implementations used to happen in the coexistence model in early 2011-12 or so. Then after 2015, people started realizing what is there in the cloud, and probably the implementations got speed up. And now most of the organizations are moving towards the cloud applications instead of being in the coexistence. Okay, that is a different story. So Oracle Cloud Applications are an integrated suite of business applications that connects and automates the entire flow of business processes. So as we said, Oracle is one of the biggest cloud provider in the market. So they have a lot of experience. So they have everything required for the business. They don't say that, okay, we only provide HCM solution for financials, to look for some another provider, nothing like that. They have HCM, financials, procurement, supply chain, sales, marketing, everything which is needed for a business. So that truly they are addressing the need of the global enterprise. Designed to ensure your enterprise can be modeled to meet legal and management objectives. Available as a SaaS subscription or with a license to install on-premise as well. But most of us nowadays, we are not opting for the on-premise. Otherwise, even that's why initially they used to call it as Fusion applications. Fusion applications are available to be implemented as cloud as well as on-premise as well. But slowly, slowly, the on-premise was getting shaded out, and mostly everybody is going with the cloud application. So don't get confused. Fusion is nothing but the again the cloud applications of Oracle only. Okay. So as I said, Oracle was one of the provider in the market. So what will be the benefits we derive out of looking at the Oracle Cloud? Lower IT infrastructure cost, lower IT operational expenses, as everything will be taken care by the provider Oracle. Lower maintenance cost, we don't need much resources. Ability to access the service via standard platforms. You may use desktop, laptops, and mobiles. The cloud applications are more mobile friendly in nature. And release after release, they are making it much, much mobile user friendly. The more small screen you use, they will be fit into that. Because this is the trendy place. Everybody uses a smartphone. There are no person nowadays, at least I can say 1% or 2% are still using the traditional mobile phones with all the pads with have buttons and pressing. Otherwise, 98% to 99% of the people today, including the old age people, are the youngsters and the even infants. Infants are operating. That's what I used to really astonish when you travel by train or when you sit in the airport and all. Small kids who are not more than 5 years of age, they'll be nicely operating the smartphones and looking at the video games and all those stuff. So that became the trend. So now a provider cannot say that you still use the laptop or a desktop to access your applications. They have to go as per the market, as per the trend. So most of your cloud applications, the aim at each release, at least I observed that they're becoming more and more mobile friendly so that you can access them on the smartphone or the iPads. Okay. So most of these handheld devices are suitable. So you can easily operate on those devices. No license, pay per user. Software is managed from central location by Oracle. So Oracle has set up a lot of data centers. Okay, everywhere. Initially, when the applications are rolled out, they were only in US. Now, every country, a lot of customers are coming out implementing the cloud applications. So they started putting the data centers. For India, we have data centers in Mumbai, Oracle data centers. Same way Australia, China, everywhere they started. So that they can capture more market. Automatic patch application. This was asked already. So patch applications will be applied. Software upgrades. So whenever Oracle comes out with new release, so like 18A, then second quarter 18B comes, whatever new functionalities are brought in that release, Oracle will automatically apply. So because of that, one thing very sure, you never stuck with an obsolete version, unlike your on-premise applications. If you have implemented Oracle e-business applications with 12.0 version, and Oracle has brought in 12.2, there is no way you can automatically move. So you have to again have your own resources, invest and upgrade yourself from 12.0 to 12.2. Same is with the PeopleSoft. If you are on 9.0, 9.2 has came up, then you have to move. You have to make your own arrangements. But in the cloud applications, whether you are on release 10 or release 12 or release 13, 18A or 17D or 18B, whenever a new release comes up, automatically those who are already subscribing for Oracle Cloud applications, Oracle will take care of those release upgrades. Okay, they will give the schedule for all the customers and they automatically do it. Because of that, what will happen is for the end users is always they will be with the latest functionalities which are presently available in the industry, in the market. You never stuck with older version. Okay, faster time to value and return on investment and rich user experience, because most of the things you can access through the mobile applications. So this is the present trend in the market. Just I put a cartoon here. How is the company's cloud computing strategy coming along? It's up in the air. Okay. So why cloud? What it solves? Cloud applications were designed from the ground up, as I said, from the scratch. They make use of the latest technology advances. They incorporate the best practices gathered from the Oracle's thousands of customers. And they are 100% open standard based business applications, so that you can usually built in the interfaces. So these are the top 10 reasons why we should go with the cloud applications. Gives business optimal performance and value. Runs Oracle's modern cloud applications out of the box. Provides comprehensive social relationship platform. This is another beauty of the cloud applications. The social relationship platforms is built within the applications. We call it as social networking. So today, most of us are very busy on the social networking sites. Okay, most of us will be part of Facebook or LinkedIn or whatnot. Okay, Instagram. So a lot of things we'll do. So the cloud applications have inbuilt such social networking. So if your organization is a global organization, that means you have offices across the world and you are sitting in one corner of the world and you can collaborate with your colleagues wherever they are within the world. You may be sitting in India in Bangalore location, but you can connect with a guy who is sitting in UK. You can connect with a guy who is sitting in US. You can connect with a guy who is sitting in Australia and make a group and keep exchanging your ideas, knowledge, everything. So you can make a social networking, but within your enterprise. You cannot connect with the outside your enterprise, but within your enterprise you can very well collaborate with your colleagues, partners, employees, etc. Okay, that social networking is already inbuilt within the applications, which doesn't cost extra. Drives new levels of social intelligence and reporting. Optimizes PaaS integration with Oracle Cloud applications. Places more autonomy and decision making in the hands of the customers, because now customers need not to worry much about the IT side. They can concentrate on the business and try to make business decisions to grow in the market. Offers customers world-class security and architecture. Allows customers to set their own timetables for upgrades. As I said, Oracle will keep giving the schedules whenever there is a new release. And if you are okay with that schedule, fine. If you have any deviations, you can inform accordingly, they'll do it. Liberates money and time for customers via completeness of the end-to-end solution and state-of-the-art data centers and global operations. And this is the cloud architecture. So the baseline will be the database, which is nothing but your infrastructure as a service, over which the built-in platform will be there, which is called Fusion Middleware, which is the best example for your PaaS. All your servers, okay, your web center, your HTTP server, SVA suite, BPM suite, okay, all these things are bundled into the middleware, over which you have the actual applications, the software as a service, your customer relationship management, your Fusion financials, HCM, procurement, projects, supply chain, all these SaaS applications are on the top layer. So it is a three-tier architecture. So middleware makes the maximum sense of the part of the cloud architecture. So the infrastructure and middleware will be maintained by Oracle. So just you will be accessing the applications, what is needed for the business. And the Fusion applications, we have three ways to choose for the existing customers. Do nothing, no immediate plans for Fusion. If somebody is on e-business applications or PeopleSoft or JD Edwards or Siebel, Oracle is not forcing them to move to the cloud. Okay, you are an e-business, fine, go ahead. If you are a PeopleSoft, fine, go ahead. Because they are still investing money on the development of e-business and PeopleSoft. But I'm doubting how long Oracle can do that. Because they are investing huge again on the cloud side also. So if they maintain PeopleSoft e-business as it is and also invest on cloud, which doesn't synchronize, at least from my perspective, I'm talking about. So definitely after some time, maybe down the lane after 3 years or 5 years or I don't know how, when, but definitely Oracle is going to stop e-business and other applications. And they say, if you are still wanted to go ahead with your e-business or PeopleSoft or JD Edwards, please go ahead. We are not going to provide any support. We are not going to do any development on that. So risk is yours. Then the customer has got no go, has to move on to the cloud because they're investing huge on the cloud and cloud is the trend in the market. So we can't say how long they will maintain these on-premise applications. So as on date, they say do nothing, no immediate plans, but probably that's what I can see in the future. So definitely we all need to make our mindset to move on to the cloud. So initially they come out with the coexistence. So you be in your core applications with PeopleSoft or e-business, but plug and play from the cloud. That is second option. The third option is replacement. So you can replace not the entire business. So I want to move HCM only to cloud, entire HCM, financials still are in e-business. Or I'll move financials to cloud, but I'll run my HCM still on e-business, something like that. So pillar or suite replacement, they call it. Even that option also they are given. But now slowly, slowly, everybody, everything, they move towards the cloud. That is the trend, okay? So in the coexistence, your core HR may be in PeopleSoft or e-business, and Oracle used to offer the talent management related modules and the compensation related modules initially for the plug and play model coexistence. So you cannot have core HR in PeopleSoft or e-business and cloud payroll. There is no coexistence like that. Only cloud performance management, goal management, okay, cloud compensation management, these are given as a coexistence models. If you want cloud payroll, you cannot coexist with the e-business or PeopleSoft. You have to move. So that was the solutions initially given. Now coexistence is very less. Slowly is faded out, and whichever customer wants to move, they are entirely moving on to the cloud. This was story maybe 3-4 years back. And most of the latest technologies are used in developing the cloud applications. So for user interface, they have used the ADF. Backend technologies, Sbase, database, Tulsi, and orchestration technologies, service-oriented architecture, or SOA suite of applications. Customization-related technologies, MES, MDS, and web center services. Security, Oracle Platform Security Services. And additional technologies, Oracle Enterprise Scheduler Service, Business Process Management. These are all the some of the technologies behind the design of the cloud applications. And in the cloud, the entire customer is recognized as one enterprise. Whether you are a global customer or you are having business in only one country, every customer is considered as one enterprise. Okay. I'll take the example of Oracle itself. Oracle is an international company, a global company, which is headquartered in US, right? So if Oracle implements the cloud applications, then Oracle is an enterprise. Okay. Within Oracle, you have different country operations, different line of businesses. So in this example, ABC is an enterprise and they have ABC Corporation. Okay, that is the ultimate holding company on whose name the entire business goes. And they may have different businesses, different products, cements product, chemicals product, okay, finance business, banking business, insurance business, whatnot. So each product area, each line of business will be identified as divisions, and each division can operate multiple countries, and each country operation of that division is called as a legal entity, where you will be registering with the particular authority, legal authority of that country, and do the business. And legal entity level, you are producing a lot of financial reports like balance sheet, etc. So if cements is operating in both India and Singapore, then ABC Cement Singapore is a legal entity, ABC Cements India is a legal entity. And your chemicals may be operating in India alone, so ABC Chemicals India. So in India itself, for this ABC corporation, there are two legal entities, Cements India and Chemicals India. So your employees get paid, whether you works in chemicals or cements, within India only, and subjected to taxation of India only. So that payroll part will be taken care by India Legislative Data Group. So now in cloud applications, whichever country operations you have, for each country, you need to have one legislative data group, which partition the payroll data, mainly because of taxation. You cannot have a common taxation among the countries, right? You cannot pay your employees in India in INR currency and ask them to pay US taxes. That's not possible. So each country operations, you need to have a LDG, which mainly take care of your payroll partition, so that in which currency the employee is paid, what is the legislation, accordingly what is the taxation, that part will be taken care by LDG. Okay, so that is the basic how the enterprise structure looks like in the cloud applications. So enterprise operation, e-business as a primary data partition. So instead of that, everything comes within the purview of enterprise. And then your LDG will take care of that partition with respect to your country, okay? No cross-enterprise data or process. As I said, however big the customer, there is only one enterprise, and within that, you can have country operations indicated by your LDGs as well as your legal entities. So the enterprise structure supports one legal version of all work structures and the people. And all customer specific data must exist within an enterprise. And LDG replaces e-business business group as a country specific data partition within an enterprise. Specifically, it takes care of the payroll partition, supports the configuration of objects within a strong legislative context like payroll, absence types, elements, and pay rates. And LDG is again specific to the enterprise. Okay, so this is the basic infrastructure and the enterprise structure of the cloud, what is provided by Oracle. So any questions, any queries at this stage before we...
I have a quick question. So in that enterprise structure, where are the business units and departments?
We will go ahead with that. Just I have given you the basic idea, so big question cannot be answered now. Okay, just it is a glimpses of what is cloud. When we go ahead with the cloud application, that's what we are going to discuss in depth. Okay, what is LDG, how it takes care, how the legal entities will take care, what is infrastructure, enterprise structure, your departments, everything will be discussed. Okay, but everything within the enterprise, that's what you need to understand. That's why I told, however big a business customer the client is, but only one enterprise structure across the globe. You may have multi-country operations, but one enterprise. It is just to have a simple example. You want to build a multi-complex township, but you will have a boundary wall. So your enterprise is like a boundary wall. Within that boundary wall, you build three-bedroom flats or two-bedroom flats or single-bedroom flats. It is up to you. But everything is within that boundary. So your enterprise structure works like a boundary within which you have your different types of businesses. You have different country operations. You have different departments, different people. Everything works within that. That is the idea. Okay. But definitely, we are going to see that only in the HCM actual cloud applications classes. Right?
Okay. So Venkat, just one quick question. Like in EBs, we had that multiple business group fund. Like, so here we have the single business group. So whatever country like that will come under that particular business group. Here we are calling it as entity, right?
The business group concept and multi-business group concept is avoided here. There is only one enterprise, and within the enterprise, LDGs. LDGs basically represents your specific country, countries. Specific context. Yeah. Okay. Because in e-business, your business group will have a legislation and currency, right? So here the LDG will have the legislation and currency. Okay, anything more?
I know, but
we will address them when we move through the training. Yeah.
Venkat, I have questions regarding the self-service processes. As in e-business, we have different kind of things like EITs, SITs, and we can configure whatever the services not available from Oracle side. We can make it by our own, and with the AME, using AME, we can give these processes to clients. But as you said that here in SaaS applications, we don't have those customizations, personalizations. So how to handle those cases? There are multiple requirements from business side most of the time when you go to implement anywhere EBIS. When you start listening, you know, from the standard, it comes like self-service process itself, 10-15 processes we need to configure where we are using as of now those EITs and SITs. So how to handle these things in
So that is what I told in the beginning. The customer mindset is very, very important. Here there is no customization allowed, okay, because it is a software as a service. No customizations are allowed. Instead of that, Oracle has put all the efforts to bring in most of the functionalities based on their previous experience as the product functionalities itself. The product is so vast and so huge, you can do the things in multiple ways. Okay, so most of the things will be addressed within the product itself. If at all there are some requirements are there, as you said, which cannot be stopped, and clients will always try to come out something which is not there. Oh, this is not there, then I want that only. This is very common trend. So that is where they have to go with the platform as a service and develop those interfaces and work accordingly. Otherwise, the applications are extensible. You can extend the applications. We have something called tool page composers, etc. And we have the BIP reports and a lot of things which will give you that questioning effect. But definitely the customizations what we do with our present applications like eBusiness or PeopleSoft are not possible. So the customer has to get prepared for that. But definitely their requirements will be most of the times addressed. Okay. If they start with the pass.
Okay, Venkat. And another thing that let's say from the user management point of view, like earlier we configure the responsibilities and all. From security point of view, if we look, like suppose a particular manager has to be given all the access for his employees, and let's say that in with the manager there is someone partner and he has some set of employees access. So those things earlier what we do with the these profile options and creating responsibilities and adding those things. Here with the role, are we able to manage those things with the role concept whatever given in this? Or
definitely we can manage. Otherwise these are very common things, right? There we have different terminology, here we have different terminology, but it will be taken care. So forget about those terminologies. There is no responsibility, there is no business group, nothing like that. But here everything is role-based access. Okay. So we have all together different platform services, security platform services. So using which definitely we can manage better way than what we do in the existing applications. Right.
Just one more question. Venkat, just about these integrations. As we say that we have, let's say that different kind of you know, ERPs or other things, other you know, softwares in place. For example, let's say I have a maximum application with which ERP interacts. So those integrations coming by default as a standard, or for that one we need to buy another separate things from Oracle?
See, for example, if you are using the cloud payroll and cloud financials, both are cloud, okay? Then if you do a costing in the payroll, easily with a transfer to general ledger process, you can move the costing towards general ledger.
Mm-hmm.
But if you are using cloud payroll and financials is with PeopleSoft, definitely you need the interface. Okay, you cannot directly with simple one transfer process, you cannot move it. As long as all your products are within the cloud, the integrations are inbuilt. We need not to do anything.
Yeah, but right? If it is Oracle, let's say that we have a maximum application and some asset related things are going to that one, and yeah, we are getting
whether it is Oracle or anything, even if you are using, that's why I took example also I took like that. You are using Oracle cloud payroll and your financials is in PeopleSoft, that is also Oracle, but integrations are not inbuilt, definitely not inbuilt. So while implementation itself, you need to ask the Oracle to do that integrations, so they will do it. Maybe they'll charge extra or so.
Okay. That's fine. Yeah, thank you, Venkat. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So I'll just walk you through the curriculum and we will end the session. Just another 5 minutes. So I think I took a little more time. So we are going to cover global HCM. And in the global HCM, or we call it as core HCM, we are going to cover the overview of HCM, then functional setup manager introduction, geographies, enterprise structure, workforce structures, grade jobs and positions, how to manage the workforce lifecycle, maintaining the worker directories, workforce profiles, HCM security, approvals, workforce records, and the checklists. These are the topics we are going to cover under the core HR or global HCM, we call it in the cloud. Then another area we are going to cover is the talent management, where we cover goal management, goals, goal library, goal plans, mass assignment of goals. Then we also cover the performance management, where we define the questionnaires, performance roles, metrics management, performance templates, performance rating methods, okay? And finally, how to create a performance document and do the appraisal. Then we are also going to cover the absence management, or you have absence management, absence components, worker availability, eligibility profiles, using the formulas for absences, lookups, value sets, and flex fields, absence element, absence plans, accrual plans, qualification plans, different types of plans, absence types, reasons, and categories, how to schedule an absence, what are the various rules applicable for absences. These are all will be covered in the absence management. And the fourth part of our training covers the payroll, cloud payroll. So prerequisites for payroll setup, payroll definition and pay frequencies, consolidation set, pay periods, how to create payroll elements. With respect to the elements, what is classification, what is element template, eligibility, element entry, deductions. Under that, we'll talk about deduction cards, involuntary deductions, voluntary deductions, event groups, object groups, payroll balances, payroll costing, payroll calculation and processing, payroll flows, and payroll security. These are the things we are going to cover. So basically, we are going to cover four areas: core HR, payroll, absence, and the talent, where we cover the goals and the performance management. This is what our complete training is all about.
So when you are going to take us through the end-to-end cycle on the instance, right, for all these four modules?
Yes.
Individual modules.
Yes, okay, definitely.
So first you will give, just to take the brief, like first you give the demo, means show the PPT, and then you'll take us through the instance showing end-to-end. Yes, cycle, like
definitely. How the I'll be doing the demonstrations. Then you will be practicing on a given environment. Okay.
So, one quick question. So, in these trainings, how much of US registration specific transactions we might cover? For instance, on payroll, would it be very generic or anything pertaining to US registrations?
Yeah, our payroll will be US payroll only, because that is what is available on the training instances. There are many things general, but when we transact, we'll definitely have this taxation, everything related to ES only. Okay, it's not specific to any other.
Okay.
So, oh, Venkat, this is Ravi. So the total duration, is it like 50 hours or what is it?
Yeah, that's what I was about to tell by the time some questions came up. So okay, it may take around 45 hours to 50 hours, not more than 50 at any cost. Okay. But yeah, that is always flexible, subjected to the discussions we happens during the class and the questions and all those things. It may spill a little over, but I will try to be within 45 to 50 hours. And which may take probably daily, we may not cover more than 1.5 hour.
Okay.
Exactly. So it will be well below 1.5 hour. Okay. So we start at 7 a.m. in the morning as per India time. I don't know how many of you are from India and how many of you are from abroad, but this is the time zone what we are going to follow. So 8:30 is the maximum. Today being the first day, I'm interacting more and I want to be more specific on the things. That's why we took a little more, but otherwise we try to constrain below 8:30 India time in the morning, so that office goers, it should not have a problem. And each session will be recorded. So if you miss out last 5 minutes or 10 minutes because you are in a hurry to move to office or somewhere, don't worry. Even if I continue up to 8:30, if you are leaving the session at 8:20, no problem. You will have that recorded session made available, so you can go through that.
And Venkat, other question I had is, do you have like, will you give any tips for certification, or do you guys have any dumps of questions, like practice questions or something? Do you have any repository that you guys can share?
Unlikely, we don't have any repositories actually okay. For cloud. Even when you search in Google also, you don't find anything.
Yes.
But definitely I will walk you through at the end, what are the different certifications available for the content what we cover. This course is designed to cover exactly the course certification requirements only. Okay, so okay, if you go through this 100%, you will be confident to take up those certifications. Okay. And I will take you and I will give the tips also, but okay, definitely you will be able to face the certifications easily. And okay, I have seen many earlier have came out color with high flying colors. Okay.
So in total, how many sessions are we looking at?
30.
Sorry, please come again.
In total, how many sessions are we looking at?
30.
Yeah, good question. How many sessions, that again depends. So as I said, maximum 45 to 50 hours. So daily 1.5 hour. And we are going to take up sessions only Monday to Friday. And again, I'm a human being. I have my own problems in the between. Okay, I may have to travel somewhere, I have my family issues, whatever may be. So sometimes you will have some sessions washed up. Maybe I may not able to take continuously Monday to Friday. As far as possible, I try, but sometimes you may get some 2 days, 3 days break also. So overall, when you look at this may span, this is September starting. So by September end, or maybe by first week of October, we are supposed to finish, which may spill up little bit here and there, depends upon the situation and availability, right?
Okay.
Sounds Venkat, good?
Yeah.
Venkat, apart from these 4 modules, so are you touching any other modules, like any time and labor?
No, not in this training. There are plenty benefits, compensation, lot. It is a big family suite of applications. So we are concentrating mainly on the modules which are basically fast moving in the market. So that's what we adopted. But if you need other trainings, probably you may have to subscribe again separately.
Yes. To add to that question, do you have any other content or course which covers OTL? The other person was asking. OTL and
then. Yeah. Definitely, we have, but not in this training.
Not in this course. Yeah, of course. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. We have OTL, we have compensation, benefits, everything is there.
Yeah.
One last question, Venkat. In the talent management, will you be covering some more minor process areas, succession planning, talent pools, talent reviews? They are very minimal and we don't see many clients actually asking for. beyond goals and performance.
That's why if you look at those things I have not touched upon. In the talent management, mainly most of the customers will be looking for performance management, which is coupled with goal management. These are the prime areas. So that's why we are covering them. Talent review, succession and all, there is nothing much actually, truly speaking. You can do on your own itself. So I don't want to waste much time on them. Instead of that, we opted for absence management, payroll and all. So only we are going to cover goal and the performance.
Okay.
Again, everything needs invest on time. That's the main reason why we choose the topics and the products. So that when you come out of this training, you will be enriched with and should be able to face the market with what are the basic requirements with respect to the cloud. Of course, other things are there, but with this, definitely you can put your footprint into the market, start with. That is the idea.
Venkat, one last question before you go. I mean, like approximately like global HR will take like what, 15, 20 hours out of its major chunk?
Yes. Major part of it will be core HR, because that is where you start learning about the cloud applications and a lot of questions will be there. A lot of explanation involves in that, because after that it will be like a cakewalk, because every time in not to tell what is LDG, what is business unit and all, but initially they need a lot of explanation. So it takes half of the time in core HR, rest will be done in a faster manner.
Okay.
Right.
Venkat, just one more thing. Is it this global HRMS is a combination of this core HR and self-service or what? Because self-service mostly I'm not seeing anywhere mentioned.
Core HR means it is including self-service only.
Okay.
Self-service is part of that. Okay, so thank you very much for your participation. Probably we'll meet in the next session. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye.
Thanks, Venkat. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.